Does anyone have the quiz from last time that didn't have a chance to turn it in? Yes, go ahead and get that to me. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Anyone else? Okay, y'all ready? Hope you had a good weekend. Y'all feeling okay this morning? Tired? 60 degrees? Yeah, that weather's making me feel a little bit better than I usually do on Mondays. All right, so there's two problems I want to go over today. I told you at the end of class last time that on your homework you'd probably get some quadratic equations that have decimals and fractions in them, that I had avoided those on purpose. So I thought we might take some time to go through an example of each so we can just see how it works. So here's our first one here. We have to first recognize that it's a quadratic equation, right? I mean, that's always the first step. What are we looking at? What are we trying to do? So here we have an equation. It's quadratic because we have x squared. So what's the procedure? How do we do these? I know you had a long weekend. So what's the format that we've been using? Okay. So that's, I'm going to say yes and no to that. It's GCF. GCF is an option, right? Quadratic formula is the other option, right? But before we do that, we want to determine if this is one of the special cases or not. All right, so we want to move everything over to one side. That's the first thing. If you have a quadratic equation, move everything to one side. Make sure you have it in descending order, which we already have, right? We have a 0 on one side, everything else on the other side, and it goes x squared, x, and then the number, right? So the special cases we have, remember the two special cases? First one is when we would be missing that, right? And the other one is when we're missing the x term. In this case, we don't have either one, right? We have all three there. So now we can either do factoring or quadratic formula. I think we would agree that the AC method, right, is not going to be very good here because we have decimals. So one thing we could do is just go right to the quadratic formula. I'm just going to put QF here, and I'll put the quadratic formula up here. X is negative b plus or minus the square root b squared minus 4ac all over 2a. Okay, so that's our formula. And now we can identify a, b, and c, right? So I'm going to do this problem just the way it appears, and then I'm going to do it again, but I'm going to do it a different way and just see which one you like better, if it makes a difference to you. Okay, so I'm going to now identify a, b, and c. So a, b, and let me call on you because maybe that'll help wake you up. Let's see who's first. Itzel. Morning. So what's a, b, and c for us here?
A is going to be
52.2. Okay. B. We do pull the negative. Yes, 26.37, and then C, negative 15.3. So we want to make sure we get the signs, and then we go straight to the formula, right? So X will be equal to, all right, what's negative B for us? Let's see. Christine Gonzalez? Oh, well, you know what? I'll come back to you. Victoria, okay. So what is the first part of our formula, negative b?
So since it's an odd number, then it's going to be negative, right? Negative 6.
I think you're looking in here already, I think, right? I'm saying what's this number right here for us?
Negative 26.3.
So it's actually, we're going to put positive 26, right? So that's one of the tricky parts. Just make sure. This really means the opposite of B, all right? Whatever you see, do the opposite. So we have a negative 26.37, so we are going to put positive 26.37. And then plus or minus square root of, now we actually have to do B squared, don't we? We have to do B squared. Now, Victoria, when we do B squared, I said in class, it'll always be positive, right? No matter what. But we're gonna need our calculators for this, right? Unless anyone knows what 26.37 squared is, no? Okay, so 26.37, and then squared, does anyone have any issues on how to square things on your calculator? Everyone's okay with that or no? I'm getting 695, and then I'm getting like point, and then I'm getting 3769, right? I'm just gonna be rounding two decimal places the whole time. So I'm just gonna make this 0.38. If you put 0.37, I'm not gonna take off, all right? But you need to make sure you get at least 695.3, all right? Any questions on that? Okay, minus, now we're gonna do 4 times A, which is our 52.2, times C. And for C, I need to put the negative, right? Negative 15.3. And then the whole thing, and I talked in class last time about making sure this division bar goes all the way across. And then 2 times 52.2. All right, there we go. So now, Victoria, I'll come back to you because you were mentioning this. How many negative signs do we see here?
Two.
Two, and whenever we see an even number of negative signs, we know it's going to turn into, will it be plus or minus?
Oh,
if we see an e, plus, right? Okay, so now what I'll do is I will write down, let's see, 26.37 plus or minus square root of 695.38 plus, right? That plus. And now what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna multiply these numbers together, and I'm not gonna care about their signs. I'm just gonna go on my calculator, 4 times this times this. So 4 times 52.2 times 15.3. I'm getting 3,000, is that right? 3,194.64. And then the whole thing, everything, all the way across, divided by 2 times 52.2, which is going to be what, 104.4? All right, what would be the next step? The square root thing? Okay, so we want to add these numbers together first, right? Add them, and then we'll take the square root. So let's add those together, and just to save myself some time, I'm going to rewrite the next line right here. And I won't need that big old, okay, so adding those up. This is 3890.02, and then this was 104.4. Okay, now at this point you have to take the square root of this number, right? So I'm going to take that, take the square root. Devin's not here. Rodrigo. You're okay with the square root on your calculator? Yeah? What is this then? What does that turn out to be? 62.37, good. So on the next line, I'm gonna keep the plus or minus, right? Keep the plus or minus, but then this is gonna turn to 62.37? All right, is that what you got? Okay, everyone good? Square root of that's that. And now at this point, this is where you do the two different cases. You say, okay, this is equal to I'm going to do the plus, and then I'm going to do the minus. All right, so I'm going to do 26.37 plus 62.37 over 104.4. Then I'm going to do 26.37 minus 62.37 all over 104.4. Kayleen, did you get either of those yet?
Not yet.
Okay. Take your time. I'm just continuing these over here. So what I want to make sure, I mean, you may be saying, yeah, I can do this, but I want to make sure you can type it in, because when you do this, there's a way to do it wrong on your calculator, all right? Did you get something yet?
Yeah, I got, for the addition, I got 0.85.
0.85, okay.
And then for subtraction, I got negative 0.35.
0.35, okay. What do y'all think? Anyone agree? Yes? Anyone disagree? Okay, so I'm not going to check it. We're just going to trust that those are the two answers, all right? Okay, what do y'all think? With the decimals, it's a little messier, but it's still the same procedure, right? Any questions, or can I proceed? We're good? Okay, so I said I would show you a slightly different way. Okay, so let me show you the slightly different way. When we start the problem, because we have an equation, okay, because we have an equation, remember that when you have equations, you're always allowed to do anything you want to both sides of the equation, right? So whenever you have decimals, you can multiply the left side and the right side by something to get rid of the decimals. So before I do that, let's just think about, you know, what happens when you multiply things by 10. Like, what if I took this number, 0.85, what if I said multiply that by 10? What essentially happens? The decimal point moves over one place. Okay, and that would become 8.5, right? If I took 0.85 and I said multiply it by 100, then it's going to move the decimal point two places, right? This decimal will move over and you'll get 85. Agree? Yeah, do we all buy this? Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to look through my decimals. Here I have 0.2, here I have 0.37, here I have 0.3. What I'd like to do is see if I can multiply both sides of the equation by something that would get rid of the decimals. So if I multiply by 10, it'll move this over, right? That'll become 522. But if I move this one over, I still will have a decimal, won't I? I'll have 263.7. Make sense? So what should I multiply both sides by? 100. 100 will make this 2,637, right? So first step is to come in here, multiply this side by 100, then multiply this by 100. Okay, so what would happen here? Decimal point moves over two places, and I would get 5,220x squared, right? And then the next one would be 2,637x minus what here? 1530, and then equals zero times anything is still zero. And now you can use a quadratic formula where A is this huge number, 5220. B is negative 2637, and C is negative 1530. And the only advantage to this is that you're not working with decimals. Okay, that's the only advantage, though. If you work it out and plug these numbers into this formula, you will get the same answers we got doing it the other way. All right, so it's your choice. You don't have to do this way, but I just want you to be aware of it, all right? Okay, yes.
Nope,
good question. No, we do not, because multiplying both sides of the equation does not change your solutions at all. So the question was, would we have to come back in and kind of undo that 100 that we had? Let me try and convince you of this. Okay, look at that equation. Everyone agree the answer to that is 2? X is 2? Okay, what if I multiply it by 100? This would become 200, and this would become 400, right? Yes, and now if I divide, I still get 2, and that answer, I don't have to do anything with it, right? Okay, good question. Okay, so now let's do one that has a fraction. And the reason I showed you that one, that way right there, is because the one with the fractions, we're gonna kind of do what we just did with the 100. So look at this one right here. This is this is a quadratic equation, yes? Yes, equation squared, right? X squared. So first step is what? Macy? First step? Everything to one side. That's how we do quadratic equations, right? Everything to one side. So when I do that, Macy, what would you get if you moved everything to one side?
2x squared plus 3x plus 7.
Yeah, let me do plus 8, and then when you move this half over, it becomes minus, right? So I'm going to subtract that half and then equal 0. We'll do that on the next line. But all right, so the negative 3x came to this side, became positive 3x. This came over, subtracted. We still have to figure out what this is, right? So maybe at this point we could, right? We could do that over here, couldn't we? But I'm not going to, all right? I'm not going to, and here's why. Because at this point, right now, I'm going to clear the fractions. So this is kind of like in the previous problem, we didn't like the decimal, so I can multiply by 100 to get rid of decimals. Here I'm going to multiply both sides of the equation by something that will get rid of any fractions I have. And so what we do is we multiply by the common denominator, least common denominator. In this case, we only have one denominator, right? It's 2. So I'm going to multiply the whole left side by 2 and the whole right side by 2. So if I do this, multiply this side by 2, multiply this side by 2, let's see what happens. We have to distribute. Hence, okay, so we're going to do this, right? That 2's got to go to every single one of those. So what would you get there?
4x squared.
4x squared.
Plus
6x. Plus 6x.
Plus
16. Minus half of 2, right? Which is 1. Equals right side?
Zero.
Zero still, right? Now, I can put those together now, right? That's just 15. See, that just saves me, like, if I would have done this step, I would have got something here, right? And then I could still distribute the 2, but you'll get the same result. This just saves us not having to do that. All right, so the quadratic equation we're looking at is 4x squared plus 6x plus 15 equals 0, right? And now, from this step, you think you could do that, right? Yes? No? I'm not going to go through this. But you could identify A, B, and C, right? 4 is A, 6 is B, 15 is C. Plug into your quadratic formula and you're good. All right? I think there's one more fraction one here. Where is it? So if we wanted to do this one, we would recognize it's a quadratic, right? Recognize it's a quadratic, and then we would move everything to one side, which it already is, right? And then we would try and clear the fractions. So what would we multiply by here? What's that?
3,
right? 3 would go through here. So what is, I'm not going to do the whole problem, but if we multiply that side by 3 and this side by 3, we should get 3x squared minus, now what's that middle term going to be? If I multiply 2/3 times 3, it's going to be negative, right? These cancel, and you just get 2, right? That's the whole idea. So you just get 2x in the middle. And then what's my last term? Plus 3 times 8, 24 is 0. And now, again, you identify A, B, and C and work on it, all right? Your only other option is to use, like, If you didn't do this step, right? If you didn't do this step, then your A is 1, your B is negative 2/3, and your C is 8, and I don't think anyone here is going to enjoy that in the quadratic formula. Would y'all agree? That would be, I mean, you could do it, but it would just be messy. You'd have to square fractions and start adding and subtracting fractions, and everyone seems to not like life quite a bit when that happens, so we're just going to convert it over, all right? All right, we are done solving quadratic equations, and now we're going to move on to the next topic, which is still quadratics, but we are now going to talk about quadratic functions. And the key word here is we're saying functions now, not equations. So recall from previous lectures, we had way back when we were studying lines, this was the equation of a line, y equals mx plus b, right? And then at some point we said, okay, you know what, we can use a different notation, and instead of writing y, we can write f of x equals 4x plus 1. So we're saying that in order to know this side of the equation, y, right, all you need to know is x. Plug in an x, like plug in, let's say, 1, and this would spit out 5. So we looked at it like a function. There was stuff that was going in through this function, stuff that went in, and stuff that came out, right? If we plug in 1, where did 1 go? Plug 1 in there for x, and you get 5, right? If you plug in 2, let's see, where does 2 go? 9, right? And we can do this all day long. Negative 1, if we plug negative 1 in there, we'll get like negative 3. The idea of a function, though, that was important is that we could never have a single input go to two places. Remember that idea? We cannot have that happen, right? This is no good. So what we're going to look at now is functions like this, but the thing over here is not going to be linear. This is not going to be a line. This is going to be a quadratic. So in general, what we're looking at now are things that look like this. All right? So if you want to compare that to what I just showed you, when we were studying lines, that's what it would have been. Y equals mx plus b, that was like the equation of a line, but we replaced the left side. We replaced the y with f of x, right? But this was just a number in front of x, right? And then just a number by itself. Here, when we're looking at quadratic functions, this is still kind of like the y, but now we have the x squared in here, and that's the important thing. That's what makes it quadratic. So a number in front of x squared, a number in front of x, and a number by itself. That is a quadratic function. And so what we want to know is what they look like, how they behave, can we graph them, just like we graph lines, right? We want a procedure for it. We do have some conditions here. The first condition is that the number that you see here, a, can never be 0. Why is that true? Why can a not be 0? Yeah, if a is 0, this is gone, isn't it? And then you don't have a quadratic anymore. So we always have to have the x squared term there. That means the a can never be 0. And then the b and the c, the b and the c can be anything or any number. Numbers. Including 0. So you could have a 0 here and a 0 here, which would just leave you with that first piece. But you have to have an x squared in there. So the question becomes, what do these look like, all right? What do the graphs of these things look like? So when you look at that, there's really two options in terms of what those look like. We all know that y equals mx plus b was a line, right? Like that's what all linear functions look like. All of these look like one of two things. And these, by the way, are called parabolas. Okay, parabolas. So it's either going to look like this, or it's going to look like this. Okay, it's either going to look kind of like a U up, it opens up like this, or a U shape that opens down. Now don't confuse it, that's a U shape, it's not a V, right? It's not a V, it doesn't have a sharp corner on it. If you draw me a V during a test, I'm going to take off for it, because it's not a V, it's got to be a U. All right, so that's what they look like. And there's this one we say opens up, this one opens down. There's an easy way to determine whether or not a parabola opens up or down. Does anyone know what it is? I'm sure some of you already know. Yes? Yeah, so it all has to do with the A, this number right here. Right? There's always going to be a number in front of x squared. So if that A right there is a positive number, it opens up. And if it's a negative number, it opens down. So this picture is when A is bigger than 0, and A here is less than 0. So we'll say here up, and then this one goes down. All right, there's some other important characteristics of parabolas. If your parabola opens up, there will always be a lowest point. Now, I should also point out, this parabola that opens up does not have to be right here. Like, it could be over here, or it could be up here, or it could be down here, right? And the arrows mean it just keeps going, right? So all parabolas that open up, they all have a very important point on them, and that would be the lowest point on the parabola. So I've drawn a few different ones here, right? Everyone understand these are different parabolas, all right? So on all parabolas that open up, there's a lowest point. And that lowest point has a name. Anyone know what it's called? Minimum? Is that what you said? It is the minimum, but it actually, for parabolas, we actually have a special name for that point. Vertex? Y'all heard that before? This right here, this point is called the vertex. Okay, so that point, that point, that point. All those points are called vertexes, all right? Now, for a parabola that opens down, you're going to not have a lowest point, you're going to have a highest point, aren't you? Okay, so that point is also called the vertex. So regardless of whether or not your parabola opens up or down, you're always going to have a vertex, always, always, all right? Okay. What are some other things about the parabolas that are important in terms of their graphs? I'm going to draw some different ones because I got too much going on over there. If you have a parabola that opens up, parabola that opens down, you have this, and here's the vertex, right? You have this imaginary line that goes through the middle of this. And that line right there is called the axis of symmetry. It's not important. It's not a real big thing in this class, but I'm going to mention it. Okay, that's called the axis of symmetry, this little dotted line. And all the axis of symmetry means is that if you take a parabola and you take, like, let's say the left side of this one, if you were to mirror it over like that, like reflect it, it would land right on top of the other side. So there's like a mirror image of the parabola of itself over that dotted line. So you never want to draw a parabola that looks like this. And this happens on tests. I see it happen. And this is a good indicator that you've got something wrong. Like, I've seen students do this. Like, they'll figure out, like, those two points are on the parabola, and this one. So they'll draw me like a U that looks like this. And that's obviously something is wrong there, because your axis of symmetry, you should be able to draw a dotted line right down the middle, and it should look like a reflection. And that obviously does not, right? So something is wrong with the way that student drew that graph. With me? Okay, so we've always got this axis of symmetry, all right? So given a parabola, we always have a vertex, right? We always have an axis of symmetry. What about x-intercepts? X-intercepts. Maybe we can take a second to think about lines. When we were studying lines, right, no matter how you draw a line, it has to hit the x-axis, right? With the exception of one case, and that would be if you have a horizontal line. If you have a horizontal line, you can actually not hit the x-axis. But any other line that has some little tilt to it must hit the x-axis somewhere, right? So for lines, always have x-intercepts, except that one case. What about with parabolas? Do you think we'll always have to hit it? We talked a little bit about this already, didn't we? X-intercepts. For x-intercepts, let me draw you three different cases. We could have this case where we would hit twice, right? We could have this case where we hit once, and we could have this case where we don't hit at all, right? And you could do the same three pictures, like reflect this one down instead and it would still hit twice. Reflect this one down, it would still hit once, and then just bring this whole one down here and it wouldn't hit. So this works for both up and down parabolas. You're either gonna have two x-intercepts, one x-intercept, or none, right? And this is tied into that quadratic formula, right? We talked about how with the quadratic formula, you could either have two answers, one answer, or no answers. So this is exactly related to that. Yes?
There are two continuous lines. You flip that last one, but it didn't hit the
x-axis. I'm saying if you reflect this down here and draw this one instead, that's a parabola that opens down that doesn't hit the x-axis. I think, what you were thinking is like from that point drawing it down. Yeah, that would not. I was saying bring the whole thing down. Okay, so we could have, for x-intercepts, we could have two, one, or none, right? All right, how about y-intercepts? How about y-intercepts? Anybody have a conjecture about what they think with the parabola we would have for y-intercept? Oh, I thought you were raising your hand, Rodrigo. No matter how you draw one of these, up or down, are you guaranteed you have to hit the y-axis? Think so? Is there a way I could draw it without? Let me get rid of these. So one thing that's important to note about these parabolas is that when I draw these arrows, it means it goes up forever, but it also is widening out, okay? So it doesn't just like, it's not like a U like this. You know, where these just go straight up. It has to widen as you go, right? So if this parabola right here has to widen, eventually it's gonna hit the y-axis, isn't it? This one I drew it did hit the y-axis. This one over here, this would widen, and eventually it would hit this y-axis, wouldn't it? And there's just no way you can draw a parabola without hitting the y-axis. You always have to hit it one time, all right? Always. So for the y-intercepts, you'll always have one. Okay, so we're gonna set out to try and graph quadratics. That's our ultimate goal is to, you know, how do we graph a quadratic? And the analogy here is that when we were studying lines, we learned how to sketch a line, right? And the easy thing about a line is all you need is two points. Two points, draw a straight line, you're done. For parabolas, you need a lot more information to be able to sketch them accurately. Now, before I actually sketch them, I thought we might talk a little bit about why we would ever want to study a parabola at all, right? Like lines, I guess when we studied lines, no one really argued about lines too much. Like, why are we graphing a line? But, lines are... I showed you a couple of examples like, you know, you could figure out how much money you make, you know, using a slope as your hourly rate or something like that. But where do parabolas come in the real world? So anyone have an idea where a parabola might be useful in the real world? What's that?
Bridges.
So like, how? What do you mean? Like in what sense? No clue? First thing? Okay. I'm sure there's something in a bridge that required solving a quadratic equation when they were designing it, for sure. Were you raising your hand, Rodrigo?
Oh,
no? My question was, you know, in the real world, where would you ever run into a parabola? Like, where do you think parabolas exist that would be important for us to study them? And when I say us, I don't mean you in terms of like your majors probably has nothing to do with this, right? But I'm saying us as in human beings at some point had to study parabolas. Yes?
Growth and decay.
What's that?
Growth and decay.
Growth and decay. Growth and decay is going to be modeled using exponential functions and log functions. So I'm glad you mentioned that. When you talk about growth and decay, that sort of thing parabolas don't work for. So we actually need a different type of function to do that. No? Okay, good. Then I'll explain. I'll try and see if it's useful. Would you like to volunteer?
For what?
Huh? Okay, thank you. Just stand over there real quick. You won't be on camera. Good? Right there, right there. So I'm going to throw this to you, all right? And you're going to try and catch it. Ready? Here it goes. Okay, good. Back to me. Okay, so this time I'm going to throw it as high as I can without hitting the roof. Ooh, okay. All right, one more. This one's going to come kind of like this. You ready? Okay, good. Thank you. That's it. So we're throwing this through the air, right? And it's got this little arc to it. That arc, there's only one arc it can possibly be. The shape of that, it has to be a parabola all the time. There's no other function. Like, obviously, a linear function is not what just happened with this marker, right? It wasn't going straight through the air like this, right? Had to go through this arc. That arc is parabolic. So for any object on any planet with gravity, you will have a parabolic path through the air, all right? So why would that be important?
Space.
Space, if you want to get to space, maybe, yeah. Let's go further back. Yes, go ahead. No, go. I want to hear what you're thinking. Come on, we want to hear, Frank. Yeah, so planes, they are, you know, they have to propel themselves, right? So that's not, it's not parabolic because when we throw this through the air, once it leaves my hand, it's only under the influence of gravity, right? So it's going to be parabolic. Now, if you put a rocket on it, then it's not going to be parabolic anymore, right? So if you look back at history, right, there was a point in time where people started building, these are terrible pictures, okay? That's a castle, okay? That's a, hey, easy. Okay, I'll put some little towers there, all right? So we started, you know, humans at some point in time started building fortresses and, you know, said, look, all of our people are going to live in here and we'll build these big walls and we'll be safe, right? Had to protect themselves from other humans that wanted to come take their stuff and convert them to whatever they believed in, right? We've been doing this our whole existence, right? We just don't agree, so we kill each other off, right? Okay, so like if I don't like what they believe and they have a lot of food and stuff I like and I want to go in there and get it, right? I'm gonna have to get into this castle. So what do they start doing? They can go and start, you know, hitting the walls, or they can start lobbing shit into the castle, right? Big fireballs and things like that. They start shooting them in here, right? Now, you can just lob and hope, right? Or if you have any understanding of mathematics, you'll know that for every single one of these, there's some quadratic function, right? Now, this may seem far-fetched, but there's some quadratic function for that one. There's a different quadratic function for that one. And if I want to land something, let's say right here, then I need the parabola that's going to give, I have to be able to clear the walls, right? So I can't use this parabola, right? I have to use a parabola that will clear the walls but hit that point. And I don't know if you can see this from my picture, but do y'all see that this is just an x-intercept of a parabola? Right? That's just the x-intercept. So I need a parabola that will maybe reach this vertex and have this x-intercept. If I know this point and I know how high I need to get it, then maybe I can generate the parabola myself, or maybe I know enough about my launcher, whatever it is, that if I change the angle, I can make that certain parabola happen, right? So imagine I'm sitting there and I pull up with my launcher. The longer I sit out there and wait to launch, the more susceptible I am to them retaliating, right, and shooting back at me. So if I can just pull up, set my dials, right, and I know if I set it to here how high and how far it's going to go, then I just launch away and then I get the advantage, right? So this is kind of like, I need to know about parabolas, right? This will make me better, and we'll be able to get in there. Yes? All right. So that's kind of a war use of parabolas. And I think we would all agree that our desire to kill one another has just pushed technology so far, right? Do y'all agree? I mean, like, if we didn't want to hurt each other so much, we'd probably still be like, right, you know, like we wouldn't have phones and, right? We would just, because what would be the need to push technology? We just love finding weapons to kill each other. I'm not exaggerating, you know that, right? I mean, we all agree with this, right? No one's going to argue with me about that, I don't think. Okay, so, all right, let's get something a little more cheerful. Let's stick with killing each other for just a second. So, when, let's say you have a target over here. I'm going to make it a target, not a human being, all right? A target, and let's say you have a person here with a gun, right? And they want to shoot this target that's really far away, right? With a rifle. Yes? So what happens when that bullet comes out of the gun? So that bullet comes out. So let's say here's the barrel. The bullet comes out of the gun, right? And what immediately starts happening? Starts dropping, right? And it, when it drops, it's a parabola, okay? It is still a parabola because it's traveling just like we lobbed the marker, except that when it comes out of the barrel, let's say this is the barrel, when it comes out, it starts dropping like this. So it's like this is already the vertex, right? And then it just starts dropping. Now, it actually goes more like this. It's dropping, but it's like the parabola is dropping very slowly, but it is dropping. Does that make sense to you? Okay, so if I want to hit a target out here, right, and my bullet's going to start dropping, I can't aim my barrel right at this, right? Because if I aim directly at this, by the time my bullet gets to this, it's going to drop. So I need to calculate how far it's going to drop. So how long is it going to take my bullet to get there? And that time will tell me how far it's going to drop. And then so, you know, snipers, military snipers that shoot targets from, you know, hundreds and hundreds of yards away, you know, they're doing all these little clicky things on their scopes and all this stuff. That's them compensating for the drop, and then they have to compensate for wind and then humidity and all these different things, and they dial in and they can hit a target from way, way far away. But it's all based upon an understanding of the parabola, all right? You have to understand that. Interesting side note. If I shoot a bullet out of a gun, straight out, okay, I shoot a bullet, and at the same time, simultaneously, I drop a bullet, which one hits the ground first? The bullet I shoot or the bullet I drop? You think same time? Most people think that the bullet that I throw this way is going to hit the ground first. I'm going to try and do it. So this is a bullet I'm going to drop. This is a bullet I'm going to shoot out of a gun. Let's see. Okay, that was not good. Let me try it again. Okay. This is obviously not a physics lab, so I can't do this like with high precision. But the bullet coming out of the gun and the bullet I drop will hit the ground at the exact same time. It does not matter that the bullet's coming out very fast. Everything's going to start dropping the same rate. So with that said, what if my bullet came out of here so fast? So fast, it's dropping, right? It's dropping slow. It is dropping. But what if as it dropped, as it starts to drop, what if the curvature of the Earth starts to curve away from the bullet as it drops? Does that make sense to you or not? The bullet's going so fast that as it starts to drop, the Earth curves. What would you get? So the bullet's trying to drop, the Earth's curving away. Bullet's trying to drop, Earth's curving away. What would you get?
Rocket.
You get a satellite.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so you know we have satellites up in space, right? So what we do is here we are on Earth. We shoot a rocket that gets a satellite going up here, and then at some point they turn off the engine, and it's all been calculated how fast it needs to be, and they turn off the engine. At that point, the satellite starts to fall. And as it falls, the Earth starts to curve away from it. and then it just keeps perpetually falling towards the Earth. But the Earth is curving away, so it just goes around. And you don't need any fuel or anything like that, it just keeps going. The moon is doing that to us, right? The moon is falling towards the Earth, but the Earth is curving away, and it's stuck in orbit. We're orbiting around the sun, right? Okay, we're going beyond where I need to go. Okay, you need something a little more cheerful, although I can tell I'm putting some of you to sleep, that's okay. any of y'all use cell phones? Anybody not use a cell phone? Yeah. Okay, so when you make a call, right, what happens? There's all these little waves, electromagnetic radiation. I've always found this amazing. Before radios, okay, there was no radio waves or like cell phone waves. They weren't out here. So if like back before radios, if you had special goggles and you put them on, you would just still see the trees and you would see the buildings and stuff like that. But now, today, if I were to have goggles that could see all those rays, I'd put them on, I'd be completely blind. I wouldn't see anything because they're all over the place. They're everywhere right now in this room. So when you make a call, right, or you update your whatever, Twitter, whatever you do, right, Snapchat, all those little waves go, and what happens to them? Where do they go? Where are they going? Okay, so yeah, you're sitting here. This is you sitting here on your phone, big old phone, the new one, right, the 10 plus or whatever it is. Okay, and so you make your call or whatever, and waves travel out in every single direction. They hit the ground, bounce, whatever, get absorbed. But the waves go out in every direction. Somewhere around here, right, is a tower. And that tower on it has these receivers. And what they are parabolas. Okay, so imagine you have this shape that looks like this. I'm sure you've seen these, kind of like a satellite dish. Y'all seen something like that? They don't look exactly like that, but most people know what I'm doing when I draw that, right? Y'all seen this? Okay, this right here, if we were to cut that in half, it would look like this with a little thing like that with a ball in the middle. Okay, this shape right here is a parabola. And the reason it's a parabola is this. Parabolas have this unique characteristic that if something comes into the parabola and bounces off the wall, it will always land at some point. No matter how it comes in, it will always wind up coming to that single point right there. And only a parabola will do this. Like if you draw a half circle, it won't work. It has to be a parabola. So this point right here is called the focus. So what happens, you got all this stuff getting scattered everywhere, right? And you got this receiver, and what this receiver does is it gathers those waves and basically collects them, and then it sends that out to the next tower, to the next tower, until it gets to where you want it to go. Okay? But you have to have parabola to do this. If you don't have parabolas, you can't do it. Now, if you're on the Earth and you're trying to make a phone call, right, to somebody over here, then you either need towers all the way around, which can be a problem because we have oceans between us, right? You either have to have towers everywhere, or you just have a satellite up here, right, little satellite, and your waves get sent from the tower up to the satellite and then maybe over to another satellite and then back down to a tower and then to this person. But every single one of these concepts relies on a parabola. You have to have that shape. It's a very special shape. One more thing, headlights. You use headlights, right? If I turn on a lamp in this room, what's going to happen? Turn on a lamp, light goes everywhere, right? But you turn on your headlight, it's more like a beam, isn't it? But the way that works is your headlight is actually a parabola that's made out of a mirrored material, and then it has a light bulb. So you have a light bulb here, and it's sending out light in every direction, right? But the thing with the parabola is that if it comes here, it's going to come straight out like this. If you put this light bulb in the right place, every light beam that comes out will reflect off and come straight out. And that creates a beam. Now, how many of you have ever used one of those flashlights where you can adjust it and like turn and the beam goes like that? All you're doing when you turn is you're moving the mirror back and forth. And so if you move the mirror back, what happens is instead of these beams coming straight out, they start to scatter out like this. They don't come out straight, they come out scattered. So your light gets spread out. Then you turn it the other way and it focuses it back in. Parabolas, all right? So I hope, there's one more thing that I'm gonna get to with parabolas, that another application, but I think this will suffice for now. Okay, sorry about that. Let's go and figure out how we're gonna graph these, because that's really what today is about. How are we gonna graph these? So how to sketch parabolas. All right, first step, make sure it's a parabola. Okay, make sure you're not looking at a linear equation. If it's a linear equation, then you're going to be graphing a line, not a parabola, right? So make sure you're looking at a parabola. The next step is we're going to find the vertex. The next step is we're going to, hold on, I'm trying to think of how I want to do this. Vertex, oh wait, sorry, hold on. Vertex is the third step I want to do. My apologies. Second step is, does it open up or down? So we're going to make sure it's a parabola. We're going to check to see if it opens up or down. That should be easy. Why is that step easy? That A, right, the number in front of x squared, will tell us if it opens up or down. The next step is the vertex. Then we're going to do this thing called a quick sketch. The fifth step is we're going to find x-intercepts, if we have them, if we have any. And sixth step, we're going to find the y-intercept. And the seventh step is we're going to do a final sketch. So we're going to go through a seven-step procedure here. Really, the first step isn't really a step, but it, you know, kind of is. We need to make sure it's a parabola. So on your next test, when I ask you to sketch a parabola, I expect everything here to be done. And I will guide you through in the question on the test. I will say, I won't guide you, but I will say, make sure to determine if it opens up or down, to find the vertex, the x and the y intercepts. You know, I'll remind you of everything that I want. All right, now, some of these things, when it comes to doing these, I have not shown you how to do them. Like, I've told you how to determine if it opens up or down, right? But I have not told you how we can find that vertex, the highest and lowest points. I haven't told you how that happens, right? I haven't really discussed this part. Five, I think we haven't done it, but I think we have talked a little bit about how we find x-intercepts. But let's do an example, and then when we get to these things we don't know how to do, I'm going to show you how to do them, all right? Okay, here we go. Let's do our first one. I want us to sketch. We'll start with a nice one that works out real good. All right, there we go. All right, first step, Caroline, what's our first step? Should I put the steps up? Did you jot them down?
Make sure it's a parabola.
Yeah, so is that a parabola?
Yes.
Yes, okay, so we got a parabola, right? Caroline, what's the next step?
Just see if it opens up or down.
Okay. Why is it opening up?
Because
the A is positive. A is the number in front of x squared. There's a 1 there, right? 1 is a positive number, so we know this thing opens up. Okay, I'll let you say just what the next thing is.
Vertex,
right? So this is the part we do not know how to do yet, right? Vertex. So remember, the vertex is either the highest or lowest point on this graph, right? Highest or lowest point. In this case, is it the highest or lowest? Lowest, because it opens up, right? If it opens up, we have a lowest point. By the way, anyone watching the World Series or any of the baseball that's going on, any baseball fans in here? Nobody? Okay, well, I was going to say, when they hit home runs, you know, when they hit a home run in baseball, the ball goes and usually lands in the stands. But then they tell you how far that ball would have gone had it not hit the stands. So if you look at this, this is a parabola, and all they're doing is they're actually able to compute the function, and then they're just finding an x-intercept. So that's why you're like, well, wait, if it hits the wall, it, you know, that's not fair because it would have gone further. Does that make sense? So since no one's watching baseball, that's irrelevant. Okay, so how do we find the vertex? Well, luckily for us, there was someone named Isaac Newton who developed this thing called calculus. And from calculus, he was able to come up with a formula for this. And all we're going to do is say thank you and use the formula. So here it is. So the vertex is always going to be a point, hk. All right? So when you look at a parabola, this point right here, I told you it's a point, right? Lowest point or highest point. We always give it a special like label. We always label the x-coordinate h and the y-coordinate k. Right? We always do. So the vertex is always this point hk. And to find h, all you have to do is calculate negative b over 2a. Now, when I say negative b over 2a, I'm talking about the a, the b, from the general form of a quadratic. So the a here is that number, and the b here is that number. Make sense? So that's all we have to do to get h. Now, to get k, what we have to do is take this answer and plug it into the function. So that means we have to take that h value and plug it into the function. So here is the formula for the vertex that I had not given you that now we will need in order to answer this question. All right, so for us, Andrea? What's my computation of h going to be, Andrea? 4 over? You have to do this part. Are you getting that from negative b? So you're taking the opposite of b, so it was negative 4, you put positive 4, and then over 2 times what? 1. 2 times 1, because a is 1. And that's just going to be what? 2. Okay. Now, Andrea, do you understand what this means or no? It's okay if you don't. Okay. I kind of hope you don't, because I want to explain it to you. This means to find k, all you're going to do is take that answer and plug it into that function you started with. So I'm going to take the 2 and plug it in here. Okay? So if we plug 2 in there, we're going to be doing 2 squared minus 4 times 2 minus 5. Andrea, does that make sense? Okay. Now we have to be just careful with things here. We square the 2. 2 squared is 4. Negative 4 times 2 is 8, so minus 8, and then minus 5. What do we get there? Minus 9? Minus 9. So our vertex, which is the lowest point on this graph, is the point 2, negative 9. And remember, this is a point, right? It's a point on my graph. All right, Kiana? I'm saying that right, yes? Kiana, what's the next step, according to what I put up here?
Quick sketch,
right? And I hadn't explained, you know, like why we do it or anything else, right? But next step is a quick sketch. So let me try and kind of explain why we're doing a quick sketch. This is step 4, quick sketch. And when I say quick, I mean quick, like boom, boom, okay? Don't label anything. I want you to tell me where this point is. So I would go, let's see, 2 means I go which way?
Right.
To the right, and negative 9 means I go down. So I'm somewhere over here, right?